All right, I'm ready to trim route my pieces using the one as a template for the other. And this is a really nice bit. It's an over-under white side bit and a big heavy-duty 3/4 inch router bit. I really love this router bit. So this gives me all the choices that I want. I'm going to trim with my template piece on the bottom. So I'm going to be using the bottom guide to trim on. I think it's just going to be a little bit better. I'm going to be able to keep an eye on the top piece a little bit more and probably not have as much fracture. But I love this bit because it gives me the choices that I want for doing both. Now I'm going to put I already have my dust collection cowl on this here, but I also have this other Festool thing. Once the blade is retracted farther back in here, I'll be able to pop this on. I think I can make this one work with this. Let me see if the two pieces of sipo will allow that. Yeah, just barely. But I'll be able to, and this will swivel around and just act as more of a dust catch. Okay, so let me get this on and then I'm going to get them clamped together and cut them. Well, I'm almost ready to cut this now. So I want to go over how this is going to go down. So here's the here's the router. I've already got it hooked up to the vacuum. I've got the depth set. I've got it locked. You can see the bit right here. So it's going to ride against this, the bottom edge, and I'm going to just trim it exactly so they're both exactly the same. Now the most important thing is that I have my orientation right. So here's up. And then here is my template piece, and this is up. So when they go into the finished piece, they're both going to be in this relationship, although they're going to be, this one's going to be on the top. But it is going to be this orientation. This much is not going to affect it. So I've got some stop blocks clamped on back here, and I'm checking my overhang. Overhang looks good. And now I'm just going to get this clamped down. This is two hand screws clamped to my work table. It's going to be more than sufficient. Now this is going to be a router demonstration is what this is really going to be. Now if I was going to just cut with the router and start here and just plow on back, you know, with the router spinning this way, I would really run the risk of, especially look at the grain coming right here. Look at this grain coming right here. If I came back here and just tried to pull this 1/4 inch of material off, I would wing and make such a mess right here, it's not even funny. So I'm going to demonstrate one of the most important things about using a router, and that's what I call the back cut. So the router is spinning this way. So I'm just going to let the router run this way. Contrary to what you think, it's going to want to run away from me. That's why I'm standing on this side of it, because it's going to blow dust that way. I don't want it blowing at me. I could do it like this. I could do it, but it's all that dust is just going to blow into me, and I don't want that. So I'm going to turn it around. Plus, I'd rather have the router running away from me than running towards me. So I'm going to let it cut and run all the way down until there's practically no material left. And then I'm going to come back in, and I'm going to do one cleaning pass into the grain, but I will have removed so much material that there's no chance of pulling off a hunk. So it's really important to be able to use this technique. And I'm going to cut the ends first, because I'm going to back cut this way because the grain, you know, the grain is lying this way. So I definitely want to back cut, and just in case I pull a hunk off as I come around this corner, I have a chance to come and clean it when I do this. So I always do the ends and end grain first. And so you'll see that it's just fussing with it and just using a little finesse. But it once you get the hang of using this back cut technique, you'll do it. But the only time you can use it is on edge work. You cannot use it on any cuts that are on the interior of the work. Because if you try to let that router run on a mortise or a dado, it will buck and jump, and you will have a mess on your hands, not to mention something very dangerous. But on edge, where it has a the chance to escape off the edge, you know, because it's going to try to run. But if you try to let it run inside a slot, you've never seen more trouble. That's one of the things that people do with router tables. They put a fence here. The router table is here. The router bit's here. They try to feed in between a fence and the router bit, and they get it fed the wrong way, or they bind it, and it's just trouble. It is trouble. It's something you don't want to mess with. Okay, so I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna move the camera back a little bit so I'm not gonna blow dust on my nice camera, and then also so you can kind of see what I'm doing. So I'm getting ready to make my ends now. And so I looked at, I took this piece of scrap, this was a drop off of our thing, and I drew these green lines on here so you could see them. And then I measured from inside to in, or outside to outside after I squared them off. Sorry, I thought I had my ruler ready. So I know I need to net from square to square. I need to net at least 13 inches to be able to then cut it to the angle that I want it. So the only material that I had in my shop to be able to say, you know, to be able to get enough material to join it and trim it down and everything. Yeah, this board is cracked, so I couldn't get that. I couldn't get the two pieces. Oh, and let me say what my overall height's going to be. My overall height from outside to outside is going to be 8 inches. So I am sticking with that dimension from our drawing, because the largest component I have is 5 inches, and that's an old receiver. But all the new stuff, the Google box and the DVR and everything, all that stuff is really thin. So I think if I leave, so 3/4 and 3/4, that's 1.5 inches, minus 8 minus 1.5 inches is 6.5. So I believe that will be plenty of room to put the stuff in and allow heat to dissipate. So I'm going to go with an 8 inch piece here. So this is pretty unusual to make a panel that is so much wider than it is longer. So it's going to be 13 by 8, but the grain has to be running this way because I'm dovetailing into here. So I found this, I know this board looks really ugly, this board of mahogany. I have this wide board here, and I know it's fairly nice because I have this bowl that I turned out of the end of it that I'm working on for a client. I like to give really good clients something for their office or what have you. So I've been working on this mahogany bowl. But I know the wood is really pretty, even though it is kind of plain Jane. But that just kind of shows you how hideous this board is. But I can. So I'm going to cut I'm going to cut a 7-inch by 20-inch piece out of this, and I'm going to lay it open, and I'm going to glue it together, two book match pieces, and then I'm going to cut it, and I'm going to cut it in my 8-inch lengths after I have it a little bit longer. But that's what I'm going to do right now. So I'm going to just use the jigsaw to cut in here like this, so I don't, instead of just lopping it completely off, so I save that bit of length if I need it. And so that's what I'm going to do. So I need to net 13. So I'm going to cut a 7. I'm going to cut a 7 rough and then lay it open. By the time I join it and stuff, I'll be 13 something, and then I'll just trim the edges off after I get closer. But this board's got a lot of cracks and checks and all kinds of weird stuff in it, so I couldn't really work it in. Plus, it's not straight at all. That's why a good reason why I'm going to take just a short section out of it. Okay, let me get on with that.